Another example is the starch. Starch consists of two elements. One is alpha amylose and other one is amylopectin. Alpha amylose is made from the glycosidic bond of alpha D glucose through the 1,4 glycosidic bond. And the amylopectin is not containing only the straight chain of alpha 1,4 glycosidic bond, but has also branching after 24 to 30 glucose units because of 1,6 glycosidic bond. For example, the glucose monomers are being added in this section. So this side is non-reducing side of the amylose, and the last sugar that is containing free enomeric carbon is the reducing end of the amylose. In the same way, the amylopectin has also reducing end. Some homopolysaccharides have a structural role. We already know the structure of the cellulose. Cellulose is a polymer made by the beta D glucose through the beta 1,4 glycosidic bonds. We can see the beta D glucose are joined in a way they are making hydrogen bond somewhere here, hydrogen bond somewhere here, this one and this way. Because of excessive hydrogen bond, they have the tough structure and they are insoluble in water. But some protists has the ability to produce a cellulase enzyme. This kind of protists are present in the gut of the wood eating termites. See, they produce cellulase and they can break this beta 1,4 glycosidic bond to use it as an energy source. Chitin is a component of exoskeleton of insects. It is a homopolysaccharide of N-acetyl glucosamine through a beta 4 glycosidic linkage. We can see each of the monomers N-acetyl glucosamine that are joined together. We can see N-acetyl glucosamine joined through the glycosidic bond. Dextrans are bacterial and yeast polysaccharide. They are made up of alpha 1,6 linkages through the D-glucose. These molecules also have alpha 1,3 linkages that are not shown here. So this is the structure of the polymer dextran. We have already discussed the amylose structure that is formed by the alpha 1,4 glycosidic bond of alpha D glucose, and this is the structure of cellulose that is formed by the beta D glucose through 1,4 glycosidic bond. So these structures also have phi and psi angles. Phi is the rotation of the first monomer around the glycosidic bond, and psi is the angle of rotation of second monomer around the glycosidic bond. Steric factors and hydrogen bonding influence the homopolysaccharide folding. So this is a plot similar to Ramachandran plot that is showing phi and psi angle of the oligosaccharides, and the z axis is showing the energy level. So these peaks are showing high energy level and they are not sterically possible. These peaks correspond to phi and psi angle of minus 170 degree and minus 170 degree. We can see here magenta color, these are at the lowest energy level. They correspond to phi and psi angle of 30 and 40 degree. So these are the sterically possible structure for the oligosaccharides. Helical structure of the starch is in a way that one glucose molecule is bent over the other molecules. Because of this bent structure of monomeric unit, the glycogen and starch have tightly coiled structure. If we see two cellulose chains that are laying side by side, so they are joined tightly with interchain and intrachain hydrogen bond. That's why cellulose is very rigid and is not soluble in water. Bacterial and algal cell walls contain structural heteropolysaccharides. Red algae and seaweeds contains agar, and agarose is one of the component of agar. It consists of galactose dimer repeating units. First galactose in the dimer is unmodified, while the second galactose contain an ether linkage between the 3 and 5th carbon, while a sulfate group is added to the second carbon of second galactose. Glycosamine glycans are heteropolysaccharides of extracellular matrix. The space between the cells inside tissues and organs is filled with a material that is called the extracellular matrix. The extracellular matrix surrounds the fibroblast and the connective tissues. This consists of mesh-like heteropolysaccharides and fibrous proteins. Fibrous proteins consist of fibrillar collagens, elastins, and fibronectin. The ECM lying underneath the epithelial cell has specialized collagen, laminins, and heteropolysaccharides. These heteropolysaccharides, the glycosamine glycans, are family of linear polymer composed of repeating disaccharide units. Some glycosamine glycans contains esterified sulfate groups. The glycosamine glycan like heldronan consists of D-group guaranic acid and N-acetyl glucosamine. We can see some example of GAGs here. Heldronan consists of almost 50,000 repeating units of disaccharide that are composed of glucuronic acid and N-acetyl glucosamine, while the chondroitin consists of glucuronic acid and 4-sulfate N-acetyl galactosamine. Keratin sulfate consists of almost 25 repeating units of dimer. The dimer consists of galactose and 6-sulfate N-acetyl glucosamine. Well, the heparin sulfate consists of dimers from these two monomeric units. In this figure, we can see the contour image of the fibroblast growth factor FGF1. This blue region show positive charge containing region, and this red one is showing the negatively charged area, and the ball and stick model shows the partial structure of heparin. When heparin binds to this FGF1, increases the growth of the cells. So this is the table showing structure and roles of some of the polysaccharides. Like glycogen is homopolysaccharide, it is used to store the energy in bacteria and in animals. Like chitin is homopolymer and it gives the structure in insects and spiders. Like agarose is a heteropolysaccharide, it is structural component in algae and cell wall material. Glycoconjugates, proteoglycans, glycoproteins, and glycosphingolipids. So first of all, we see what the glycoproteins are. Glycoproteins contain one transmembrane protein that is attached with branch chain or straight chain oligosaccharides. In the glycoproteins, protein is the major component, while the carbohydrates are present in smaller proportion. We can see the oligosaccharides are joined to the nitrogen of asparagine amino acid of the protein, or they can be joined to the oxygen of serine or threonine amino acid of the protein component. Proteoglycans in a way that have the glycan in excessive. Almost 90% of the proteoglycan consist of glycan component. So this again has one transmembrane protein that's attached with it one or more glycan component. Sometimes these glycan components are highly sulfated, like chondroitin sulfate, like heparin sulfate. So we can see here definition. Proteoglycans are the macromolecule of cell surface or extracellular matrix in which sulfated glycosamine glycans are joined covalently to a membrane protein, while the glycosphingolipids are those oligosaccharides that are joined to the sphingolipid on the cell membrane. We can see here closely the structure of proteoglycan. It consists of repeating units of glucuronic acid and 4-sulfate N-acetyl galactosamine. This is the chondroitin sulfate that is attached to the protein component through a tetrasaccharide bridge. This is the 4 monosaccharides that are making a bridge between the chondroitin sulfate and the serine of the protein component. Proteoglycans are glycosamine glycan containing molecules of the cell surface and extracellular matrix. We can see the definition of syndican here. Syndicans have a single transmembrane domain and an extracellular domain. They consist of 3 to 5 of heparin sulfate glycans, and they in some cases they have chondroitin sulfate. Glypicans are attached to the membrane by a lipid anchor, that is the phosphatidyl inositol. We can see here the structure of syndican. This is containing one and one transmembrane and one intercellular domain. That is containing 1, 2, 3 heparin sulfate, and it is containing 2 chondroitin sulfate. While in the case of glypican, it is containing the globular domain that is containing 14 conserved cysteine residues that are involved in making the disulfide bridges. This glypican is attached to the membrane through the GPI anchor. Heparin sulfate has the conserved NA domain, while the NS domains are variable among individuals. These NS domains are highly sulfated. These highly sulfated domains are very important in biochemistry. Like heparin binds to the antithrombin through its NS domain that then attaches the factor SA, that is blood clotting factor. Thus, the addition of heparin sulfate prevents the blood clotting. Heparin sulfate also helps in the protein-protein interaction. NS domain attached to the antithrombin and the thrombin at different NS domains. Thus, the two proteins come in close contact for the interaction. The NS domain of the heparin sulfate binds to both FGF ligand and its receptor. Thus, it helps the receptor ligand binding. It also helps the localization of lipoprotein lipases that are highly charged, and they bind to the NS domain of the heparin sulfate. Proteoglycans are glycosamine containing macromolecules of the cell surface and extracellular matrix. So this is the one of the example of proteoglycan in which there is the backbone of hyaluronan. This is the hyaluronan backbone that has been amplified somewhere here. It is containing almost 50,000 disaccharide repeating units. And this base is called aggrecan. This is protein in nature. This aggrecan is attached with the chondroitin sulfate and the keratin sulfate. And this protein base is attached non-covalently to the hyaluronan through the link proteins. We can see here the extracellular matrix. Some of the important components of the extracellular matrix are integrin proteins that are present both outside of the cell, and they are attached to the actin filament inside the cell. They are found in the form of pairs. The other important protein is the fibronectin that is also found in the form of pairs. They bind to the integrin and many other proteins in the extracellular matrix. We can see here proteoglycans are present in the extracellular matrix. We can see here the oligosaccharide and the other carbohydrate bind to the protein through the specific group. For example, N-acetyl glucosamine bind to the serine residue through the oxygen, and this kind of linkage is called O-glycosylation. And if the anomeric carbon of N-acetyl glucosamine bind to the nitrogen of the asparagine, then it is called N-linked glycosylation. Glycolipids and lipopolysaccharides are membrane components. Oligosaccharides are not only joined to the proteins, but they are also joined covalently to the lipids. Gangliosides are the lipids of eukaryotic cells. They do have a polar head group that is attached with the oligosaccharides. Lipopolysaccharides are the outer membranes of the gram-negative bacteria. Lipopolysaccharides consist of 6 fatty acids and 2 glucose amine molecules, and one of the glucose amine molecule is attached with oligosaccharide. E. coli has unique lipopolysaccharides. Lipopolysaccharides of some of the bacteria is called the endotoxin. So this is the structure of lipopolysaccharides of bacteria. It is containing lipid A, core, and O-specific chain. So lipid A portion contains 6 fatty acids. You can see these are 6 fatty acids. These 6 fatty acids are joined with 2 glucosamine molecules, and one of the glucose molecule is attached with core A portion. Core A portion is called the endotoxin. O-specific chain consists of oligosaccharide that is the determinant of the serotype. Carbohydrates as an informational molecule, the sugar coat. In the glycobiology, we study about the structure and function of glycoconjugates. Specific oligosaccharide encodes specific information. like the targeting of the proteins, cell-cell interactions, cell differentiation, tissue development, and the extracellular signaling. Our discussion in next few slides will be about some of the examples about the information that is contained by the oligosaccharides. Lectins are the proteins that read the sugar code and mediate many biological processes. Lectins are found in all organisms. They are protein in nature. They can bind to specific carbohydrates. Lectins serve as a wide variety of cell-cell recognition. They work as a cell signaling element, and they also work in the adhesion process of the cells. This way, targeting all the cells is carried out. Some peptide hormones that are present in the blood have oligosaccharides. These oligosaccharides determine the circulatory half-life of those proteins. This is the example in which the code of oligosaccharide is carried by the leukocyte. So these are the capillaries, and this is one of the leukocyte molecule. And this is one of the leukocyte. This leukocyte is containing a pair of integrin proteins, and is also containing glycoprotein that is on the surface of this leukocyte. This glycoprotein has specific binding affinity with the P-selectin. This is P-selectin. This P-selectin binds with the glycoprotein and determines the tethering and the rolling of the leukocyte. The leukocyte has integrin proteins that can bind to its ligands that are present on the surface of capillary. This kind of binding between the integrin and its ligand determines the slowing down of the leukocyte and also arrest of the leukocyte. When leukocyte reaches near the site of inflammation, its integrin can bind to the ligands and also its glycoprotein can bind to the P-selectin. And this process is called adhesion. At the site of inflammation, this integrin and the glycoproteins help in the excavation of the leukocyte, in which they escape from the capillary to the site of inflammation. Lectins are proteins that read the sugar code and mediate many biological processes. These are the ball and stick model of N-acetylneuramic acid, oseltamivir, and zanamivir. Influenza virus has an enzyme neuraminidase. It has a ligand N-acetylneuramic acid. Under normal condition, the N-acetylneuramic acid binds to the neuraminidase enzyme. The amino acid 276 loses its downward bend and this becomes inactive. But there is a mutant form of influenza virus that has mutation in the neuraminidase enzyme, and even upon the oseltamivir binding, this downward bend is still sustained. The Helicobacter pylori, this cell adheres to the gastric surface of the stomach. This bacterium has the specific lectin on its surface that bind to the LAB oligosaccharide that are present on the epithelial cell lining inside the surface of the stomach. So this is the growth of H. pylori. Lectins are the protein that read a sugar code and mediate many biological processes. We see another example. This is the enzyme mannose-6-phosphate receptor. And this is the mannose-6-phosphate structure that is inside the active site that is fitting inside this enzyme. And this is the cofactor manganese. We can see here the mannose-6-phosphate has hydrogen bond with several of the amino acids that are present inside the mannose-6-phosphate receptor. For example, this is one hydrogen bond, second, third, fourth, and five. At least at five places, this mannose-6-phosphate has attraction and hydrogen bonding with the mannose-6-phosphate receptor. This way, we can see the proteins have the specific interaction with the oligosaccharides and monosaccharides. We see another example. In this example, this is the molecule of galactose and this is the surface of the lectin. Mannose has somewhat polar area above its chair. that makes a hydrogen bond with the lactam, but bottom of its chair is somewhat hydrophobic. So this hydrophobic region makes the hydrophobic interaction with the indole moiety of the tryptophan. We can see another example. In this example, we can see that this is the surface of the cell, and this is the glycolipid that is embedded on the outer surface of the cell membrane. And we can see this is the oligosaccharide chain that is bound with the plasma membrane. This is the oligosaccharide chain that is bound with the plasma membrane protein. And we can see here, this is again a plasma membrane protein that is connected with oligosaccharide that can have interaction with the cell surface receptor of the viruses. Some of the bacteria release toxins before they start proliferating, like the cholera virus releases toxin that binds with the glycolipids. We can see the bacteria has also cell surface receptor that binds to specific oligosaccharide that are present on the eukaryotic cells. And leukocyte also have some sugar coat that can specifically bind to the P selectin. So these sugar coat not only work on the surface of the cell, but they also work inside the cell. For example, this is mannose-6-phosphate receptor. This mannose-6-phosphate receptor selectively binds to the oligosaccharide coat that is present on an enzyme that is determined for the lysosome. So because of this coat, the mannose-6-phosphate receptor binds and collects this enzyme and targets it to the lysosome. So the sugar coat is working in the extracellular space and also inside the cell. Working with carbohydrates, glycoproteins or glycolipids are first of all treated with endoglycosidase. Endoglycosidase releases all the carbohydrate portion of the glycolipid or glycoproteins. These glycolipids and glycoproteins are in the form of oligosaccharide mixture. These are then separated by the use of ion exchange chromatography or gel filtration or lectin affinity chromatography. After the separation, some classes of the oligosaccharide are separated, but then their identification starts. For the identification, we can do hydrolysis by the use of strong esters. So all the glycosidic bonds are broken down to convert them into the monosaccharides. These monosaccharides are separated by the high performance liquid chromatography, and sometimes they are derivatized. If they are not derivatized, they are analyzed by HPLC and mass spectrometry, and if they are derivatized, they are analyzed by gas chromatography. After these analyses, composition of the mixture is known, and types and amounts of each of type of monosaccharide is also determined. In the second way, the exhaustive methylation by the use of methyl iodide is performed. So all the hydroxyl groups are methylated, and after this methylation, acid hydrolysis is performed that breaks all the monosaccharides that are containing OH except that are involved in the glycosidic bonds. This kind of analysis produces the information that enables us to know the position of the glycosidic bonds. Though these series of experiments determine the sequence of monosaccharides that are present in oligosaccharides and polysaccharides. In this strategy of experiments, enzymatic hydrolysis with specific glycosidases is performed. Then smaller oligosaccharides are obtained. These smaller oligosaccharides are in the form of mixtures. So each oligosaccharide is subjected to methylation or enzymatic analysis. So these all kind of experiments help us to determine the sequence of monosaccharide and the position and configuration of each of the glycosidic bond. To know the structural information, we perform NMR or mass spectrometry. So these tell us about the sequence of monosaccharide and position and configuration of glycosidic bonds. So this is a typical fragmentation and identification pattern that is obtained by the mass spectrometry. We can see at 4100 molecular weight, there is one specific oligosaccharide identified. First of all, the peak of this oligosaccharide is obtained. After the fragmentation pattern of this oligosaccharide is obtained, that helps us to identify different of its monosaccharide. In the same way, all the oligosaccharide are fragmented and then identified with respect to the type. This is also very important experiment. In this kind of experiment, we can know which of the protein has specific interaction with what kind of oligosaccharides. We take a set of oligosaccharide and we immobilize those oligosaccharide in separate wells in a multi-well plate. After these oligosaccharides are immobilized in the multi-well plate, we take a protein that we want to analyze for their interaction with oligosaccharide and join this protein with some of the fluorescent material that has been shown green here. This protein is dissolved in a solvent and then is dispensed into the each well. After some time is given for the interaction, these wells are washed with another solvent and then fluorescence is detected. Only those wells will give the fluorescence that have the interaction with that oligosaccharide. So thanks for watching.